Time starts now. Hello, I'm host Eric. I'm here with host Zachary, back with Megabro, and a cast of assorted famous people in the wings here who I want to encourage to join in, please. I know I tend to monopolize the conversation because I'm so such a chatty Kathy, but we do have Adam Omega, famous person Adam Omega, famous person INFP listener, also Eric fan. I think she's talking, or he is talking about me. I don't know which one. JC, I don't know if that's the other JC or a different JC. Famous person JC. Famous person Jason F, whom we know. Famous person... How do you say it again? Leah.
Yeah, Leah.
Famous person Lorenz. Famous person...
They're
pretty
difficult to say.
Mega... Well, because you can pronounce like four different ways. Lay. Leia. Lee. Layla.
Whoa.
Famous person Megabro. Famous person Nande. And famous person 6Z66. Okay, so Megabro, what would you like to talk about? You suggested wisely we end that one and start a new one.
I was kind of curious about the negative rights framework. I don't have the details on it, but it does sound compatible with something I wrote up when I was like 18. I was wondering if I could contribute anything.
Wait, I have two things to say. One, how old are you, Megabro?
32.
32?
Yes.
I see. And the second thing to say is, I'm also interested in the negative rights frame. Let's talk about it.
Okay. So, why don't we start with any questions that anybody has as a starting point? Megabro or anybody else have any questions about it?
What's a right?
That which confers a duty upon another.
Are rights equivalent to duties?
They're equivalent to that which confers a duty upon another.
So they're the precursor to a duty?
They're the conferrer of a duty.
I think it's where duty and for upon another intersect.
Say that again, please.
It's where duty and confer upon another intersect.
Right. There you go. Is that corner of those two streets.
Duty and confer upon another intersect.
Other questions? Anybody else have questions? You want me to just give a little spiel to hurry things along, or what?
Right, so, I don't know, I want to, like, I'm trying to think of, like...
If you're going to write anything down, it's going to take forever.
No, we're still talking, like, what? I don't want to, like, stagnate the conversation. I'm just taking the small... but it helps me remember it better, I've noticed. I learned that during the debate stuff, but... that which confers a duty upon another, is it... I still don't understand how it would be different than a duty... because if it bestows a duty upon
who has it? If I have a right, I don't have a duty. Someone else does. If I have a duty, I don't have a right. I have a duty.
So if you have like a voting right, then it's a duty for the government to actualize your exposure to. It's the government's job to actualize your voice.
If you were to claim that voting is a positive right, then it would be the government's duty to provide you an opportunity to vote. If it were your position that voting is a negative right, then it is every other individual's duty not to interfere with you taking advantage of that opportunity to vote.
Which one is it then? Positive?
Well, voting is a unique thing. I'd rather not get into voting specifically because it assumes a social contract first, and so it's a messy one. But you can basically ask me about any other right but voting. Voting is unnecessarily complicated to get into right now.
Right. Okay. So let's start off. Do people have a right to health care?
No.
But they have a negative right to not have someone, prevent them from bandaging up their arm.
Yeah, the negative right to contract. The negative right to make contracts and to be not interfered in doing so. So they can seek a medical practitioner and seek his attention and offer him goods or money in exchange.
Yeah, see, the way I see it is like the whole, like, if you frame it under, you enlightened me with the whole, do people have a right to water? If you frame it under people have a right to water, that implies that, okay, let's codify right to water. Let's say you humans have a right to water under our nation. Okay, if you isolate yourself, sit in a room, dehydrate yourself to the point of death, whose fault is it? If you say it's the person's fault, then basically what you're saying is that the government should hold a gun to your head and force you to drink water. If you say that it's your community or your close family's obligation or duty, then you're saying that if your urine reaches a certain level of yellow, then the government should hold guns to your family's head and force you to drink water.
Yeah, pretty much. Or at least I'd be justified then. Listen, I am justified in forcing you to drink this water because my only other option is to violate your rights. It's obviously wrong for me to violate your rights, therefore I'm going to physically force this on you. But wait, but that's violating my rights. Hold on, there's a contradiction here. See, that's why you can't call that thing a right, because then you have created a contradiction. And what people could call it, however, is an entitlement, and I think that might be a reasonable entitlement to claim. That if you are going to claim any sort of social contract entitlements, say the government should provide you electricity and water and utilities and stuff like that, would be a reasonable claim of how they ought to use the tax dollars, to me, it seems, if you're going to make those kind of claims at all.
So you think people are entitled to water then?
I don't think they are. I think that that might be a reasonable claim to make upon your government. That's the thing about it. Entitlements aren't something that you are. There is a temporary status. We're currently entitled to this according to the rules, right? The rules are subject to change. Rights aren't subject to change. You're subject to forfeit.
That's a good way to frame it, yeah. Rights aren't subject to change, they're subject to forfeit.
Any other questions?
Anybody? Yeah, what questions do you have, Megabro?
Yeah, I was wondering, this is a negative rights framework, so there must be some negative rights that you say shouldn't be imposed upon. What are those?
One. There's only one. Rights of non-interference. From which all other rights are concluded. So, basically, there's really only one right, which is a property right. The right that you own your own body, and then the fact that you own the product of your labor followed naturally from that. So, since you own the product of your labor, and the product of your labor is not always instantaneously consumed, it follows naturally that you have property rights. Once we assume we have property rights...
Let's go back to the leap of... Here, you have a right to your own body, because you can't take it away from you. No one else can think for you, so you have to assume you own your own thoughts. And no one else
can neither give away nor sell or offer to somebody else your own moral agency. It is not metaphysically possible.
Mm-hmm. But not so yet.
We have to assume that we own that. Now, how do we extend that to like me owning this capo?
Well, because if you own your own body, you should own the product of your labor as well, right? If I own my arm, that means you can't force it to hit a nail with a hammer on your behalf and not on my own behalf, right? If you're making claims upon my body and what it ought to be doing, then you're making ownership claims upon my body. If I own my own body, then I can choose to hit a hammer. Now, it naturally follows that if everything I make and build and work on, you run right up and take away from me, then functionally, you are making an ownership claim upon my body. Because whether or not you forced the hammer to build it for you, or whether you came up and took it from me after I built it, and you didn't tell me I was building it for you in the first place, is irrelevant. The thing that matters is the fact that you're making an ownership claim upon my body, or the product thereof, the product of my labor, which necessarily must follow is my own if I own my own body. Because otherwise it would be an ownership claim upon my body.
So, tell me if I have this accurate then. So let's say, under the conception of a business, then you have capital, and you're going to say, okay, Zachary, I've noticed that you've been really sculpting those rocks. Those rocks you've been sculpting into small figurines look really nice. I will give you a positive right to contractual capital if you give me your labor. Is that accurate?
I want you to work for me making those rocks, and I'm going to sell them.
Mm-hmm. Right? So that would be the essence of a business?
Well, that's the essence of a dumb business. A good business, the right kind of business, is the rock seller goes into a business selling his own rocks, or partners with somebody who takes care of all that businessy shit in order for part of the monies, even split preferably. That's a good arrangement. You want partnerships in the world. Partnerships are very, very powerful compared to being going it alone and being the only guy who's in charge, the only guy holding all the responsibility, and the only guy holding all the ownership. It's a lonely thing to do. Partnerships are great. What's not great is exploitative relationships where you find talented people and get them to work for you at an hourly wage and then sell their shit at much higher prices and keep the difference for yourself as though you had done something of significance. To me, it is significant to do the business stuff if you are doing it with in a moral way in a partnership with the people who actually provide the talent. If you're not dealing with the talented people who are doing the thing that is actually of value, doing the real work, a good chunk of the income, at least as much as you're getting, then you've got a big moral problem, in my opinion. But that's a personal moral problem. They're not actually ethically obligated in under this framework to do any otherwise.
What are your thoughts on worker unions?
They're garbage. They're contingent upon there being a limited population there, or upon the unions being able to violate other people's right to contractual to make contract with the employer.
Mm-hmm.
This notion of artificially protecting the right to strike is complete garbage.
Mm-hmm. So business owners, I think I tend to agree with you. I don't think they should be ethically obligated to meet any sort of standard. But if they aren't, I mean, if they're not paying enough to their workers are going to go somewhere else. And if their prices are too high, people aren't going to fucking buy from them. So I think it kind of, the free market runs its course that way, right?
Right. Well, look what happened to Kudos. They thought coaches were replaceable. They learned the hard way. I told that bitch, I'm like, this isn't like a fucking burger flipper at a restaurant. Coaches aren't replaceable like that. Your program's going to fall to pieces. And the only way she's propped it up is by getting the best, most expensive coach she could find. More expensive than me. So it fucked her. And he's not loyal at all. He's leaving. Why should he be loyal?
He's leaving now?
Yeah.
That's great. That is fucking great. Not the all topic, though.
Yeah. So, you know, that's what happens when you be an exploitative business owner, right? And I never even asked her for more money at all. You know, that's the thing. I just said, you're not going to treat me like an underling. She didn't like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know how we got off on that. What are we talking about again?
We're talking about negative rights framework.
All right.
The essence of... So what's the claim to property, then?
A claim to property is simply that one should, that if you don't possess the rights to your own labor, in other words, a claim to, saying this is my property means if you take it, you are the person who has forfeit his rights. I still maintain mine. And what does that functionally mean? It means, I think it simply means this. If my rights are violated, it means I'm right and you're wrong. And if you're the one who has your rights violated, then you're right and I'm wrong. The rights is who gets to be right. And we should all agree with that. And the extent to which this correctness is manifest as objective, forceful reality, it is done so through the mechanisms of TE and, big group agent, stuff like that.
So the essence of the negative rights framework, does it need to be actualized by a monopolized force?
Okay, well, the issue of monopoly of force, I do think there should be a state. I'm not for anarcho-capitalism per se, pure anarcho-capitalism. I think there should be a state. I think the state's job is to enforce the negative rights framework. And go ahead.
I'm not really in favor of a state, with A meaning the word one. When there's only one of something, it's a lot riskier in case something goes wrong.
Good point. But remember, these are rules-generating machines that are very weakly influenced by whether or not the rules are needed or good. So the more machines you have, the more rules you have, too. I agree with localization of power being a good counterbalance against centralization of power, that doesn't exactly mean more. It should mean covering fewer people.
So, okay, let's go. I want to address let's go back to the healthcare thing, like a right to healthcare. When people say they should have a right to healthcare, aren't they saying that the government should have a duty to provide their citizens healthcare? Do you disagree with that?
I think that's what they mean, and I think it's important that they use that language. They say, I believe that the social contract affords me an entitlement to healthcare, rather than saying people have a right to healthcare. Then at least they're saying something that's honest, and they understand that they're making that distinction. I don't like the fact that people don't distinguish between those words, because it means they don't think it matters that they're distinct.
That's a good point, yeah. The problem with the government providing healthcare is that healthcare comes as an art. There's an art of medicine. There's an art of medical sciences, right? So it's like, if the government has an obligation to provide healthcare for its citizens, what that means in essence is that if I went to school to become a doctor and I became proficient in medical sciences, then the government is going to coerce me into treating people and using that art. Does that follow logically?
I don't think they coerce the practitioners into practicing. I think they coerce them into practicing this way or that way a little bit. But I think the people who are doctors, they want to be doctors. They're not being coerced into that field. But once they get into that field, they have to operate according to a bunch of regulations and stuff that are driven by the government. So that's why when I go in with a broken finger and I go to the doctor and I'm a cash patient, one of the last ones in America apparently, the doctor's like, yeah, like 0.0001% of our patients are cash patients. And I was like, 0.000? Do you really even have that many patients? anyway, how can I possibly be that small a percentage of your cash patients? Anyway,
Let's
cost
do
me
this
30
thing.
Bucks. Why does it cost me 30 bucks and it costs somebody with insurance $300? Why?
It costs you 30 bucks?
Yeah, 40, I think. 35, 30,
wait, really?
Something like that. Yeah. It was the minimum they can charge, she said. I'll just charge you the minimum we can charge. Why did it charge that much? Because she saw me for freaking 10 minutes. She knows it's worth that much, you know? At that rate, she's making 240 bucks an hour. I mean, granted, she's got the office staff and stuff. But, you know, and she probably felt bad for me, right? She was like, oh, this poor guy's a cash patient. I need to make it cheaper. I didn't want to spend a whole shitload of money. Because she would feel bad about charging an outrageous amount of money for seeing me for 10 minutes. Because she's dealing with a human being, right? She's not dealing with an insurance company. She's not dealing with a government regulation. She's dealing with an actual human being. And an actual human being, it's outrageous to charge $300 to see me for 10 minutes. It's not outrageous to charge me $30
bucks. Do you think health insurance companies should be excised?
I'd get rid of them entirely. I think the thing is this. I put it this way. I would allow people to get health insurance if they want to. I would take away all regulations that require employers to provide any health insurance. I'd discourage employers from providing health insurance. I'd rather buy my people a phone and get them on a company phone plan or something like that. I can't afford to get everybody fucking health insurance. It's insane.
I don't think business owners should be forced to supply their employees with employees with health care. I don't think it should be enforced.
You know what employers are required to do with employees, but not with independent contractors? They're required to contribute something like 12% to their Social Security fund every year. Every month, I mean. Like, whatever your employee pays in Social Security, you have to pay an additional 10% of that or something like that if you're an employer with employees, per se. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. Why should that be the case? Why, if I give somebody a job, do I have to pay into their retirement fund and give them health insurance?
Let me play the devil's advocate here. If the government has a duty to, under a social contract theory, there's the government would have a duty. The citizens would have a positive right to remain, I guess. Let me find a way to frame this.
Okay, let me talk about social contract a little bit to set this up. The social contract basically states that we make a deal with a state. When a state, we afford them the monopoly of force, and we in exchange get the expectation that we can demand certain services in exchange for this. First and foremost, we can demand defense against external aggression. And second, ideally, we could demand defense against internal aggression by other citizens. And that's basically it. You might say roads, stuff like that, too.
So that's like courts and police, right?
Well, this is the thing about the social contract theory. The problem with social contract theory is, number one, there's no actual contract. I never agreed to any contract. There's no piece of paper we can point to that says what powers they get and what rights we don't. That's called the Constitution. If you say, well, Constitution is just an example of social contract theory manifesting, you say, no, Constitution is an example of constitutionalism manifesting. Why is it an example of constitutionalism and not social contract theory? Because it's specific, right? And if you're going to argue constitutionalism, fine. But then constitutionalism, too, does not address the core question of why is it that it's okay for this individual person to aggress against me because they've got this badge on their shirt or whatever. And it never does address that. It never addresses that. And how can it possibly be a contract if nobody agreed to it? Isn't a contract, by definition, consensual agreement between two parties?
Mm-hmm. It would be. Does the government, under the social contract theory, would the government be have a duty to keep its citizens safe?
Maybe. From external aggression, according to classical social contract theory, yes. From external aggression, for sure. They have a duty to do that. That's one thing that everybody agrees on with social contract theory, is that you give up the monopoly of force to the government, and then they protect you from external aggression. Everyone agrees on that. Well, even the internal a little bit it gets immediately squishy, right? Well, what constitutes as internal aggression? If the government official does it, is it internal aggression? What if he says he's doing it as part of the defense of against external aggression? Well, now it's okay for the government to do that, right? Because the government has now a free pass to take all sorts of claims upon your liberty in exchange for the services it provides. We have no list of which claims are okay for them to make and which claims are not, and we have no list of which services they're going to provide and which services they're not. No way to hold them accountable, except their constitutionality. So what the fuck is social contract theory there for in the first place?
Mm-hmm. Don't we have to presuppose social contract theory in order to argue for a logical system, though?
No. I think you say we are mystifying an entity that doesn't exist, this thing called a government that supposedly protects us. We are personifying it. We're using a, what's it called?
I mean, doesn't the government exist, though?
Well, hold on. We're using what's called a, what's that fallacy called? I can't remember. Anyway, it's the one where you treat things that are not agents as though they were agents. The problem with a government is it behaves very much like an agent because it's comprised of individuals following protocols. And each of those individuals feels as though they're divorced from any real action against other individuals because they're only doing their part of the protocols. The problem is, of course, protocols can't be held morally accountable for what happens. Only individuals can. And so the trick of government is to diffuse out the behavior of the individuals through a set of different protocols and a bunch of different individuals so that no individual is ever morally responsible for anything and nobody can ever be held accountable for anything. And then even if you get a bad, the solution to democracy is if you get a really bad person in there who does a bunch of stupid ass shit, they get voted out, the shit they did is still there, right? There's no expiration date. Huh?
Isn't that a republic?
But who cares what it is? The problem is the system has no check and balance towards eliminating bad ideas that are already put into place. And the system is designed to put ideas into place. And the system is inadequately vaccinated against people with bad ideas because it's not founded on principalism.
Hmm.
Speaking of principles, My idea didn't go into this high a scale. It was more on an individual level. Basically, all I did was took a definition of what's required for a person to be a person and said, hey, don't violate these things, because if you violate these things, you destroy a person. Person has to have the ability to think and make decisions and get access to information and communicate and have a body, stuff like that. And if you violate those things, you destroy the personness of a person.
Oh, Zachary. Can you smell that framework? Can you smell that framework around? I love that framework, Megabro. I think it's bullshit in terms of this particular thing, because you could always argue, well, look, what you're doing is actually limiting my ability to communicate, and thus you're violating my rights, even though I'm not actually doing anything to limit your ability to communicate. It's too mushy. That's the thing I don't like about it as a codified principle. I love the idea of the debate framework, though. It's fucking brilliant. You are not just dehumanizing them. You are preventing them from being human if you eliminate any of the component factors that necessitate a human, that is necessary to be fully human. And then you're putting this burden, a necessary but insufficient burden. Each one is a necessary but insufficient burden upon your opponent before the round even starts. They'll have to run Nibs Bad as theory, which is saying they can't run all these necessary but insufficient burdens, but they're not positioned like that, right? They're not positioned like burdens. It's perfect. I love it. You got what's the list of things? What's the list of things that make it required to be human?
Oh man, I'm just going off of what I can remember. I wrote it down 13 years ago.
Well, you wrote down a good debate framework. We'll pull that one out of the ashes and lay some lumber with it. You know,
because the things that human capacity for thought, a moral agency. Well, under that framework, you could argue that anything aside from democracy would be minimizing the human aspects of an individual or their voice, and that would be advocating for.
I say there's one thing with five components. The one thing is moral agency that is required to be fully human, but there are five components of moral agency, and then we just, whatever those five things are, we just come up with five whatever things, you know? It could be expression, reason, empathy, freedom of action, or freedom of movement, and tickets to the poop gathering festival.
Tickets to the boot gathering festival?
The poop gathering festival. It was a joke. I couldn't think of a fifth one.
Oh, the poop gathering festival.
Yeah. Remember? You were elected king of it last year. You don't remember?
Explain. What's the poop gathering festival?
It's a yearly festival that's held year-round where all the people go to the poop gathering fields and then they shoot a firing gun up in the air and everybody runs and they gather as many poops as they can into their basket and they come back to the judge and say, "Do I have the most poops?" And then the judge goes, "Nope, you only got 412. This guy's got 670 or whatever." You know? Remember? Now do you remember?
Okay, yeah.
I was concerned you had forgotten about it. I'd be worried you had amnesia.
Well, okay. I want to go back to the, you say we treat a government like an agent, but we mystify it in the sense that it doesn't actually exist? Is that the claim you laid down?
Well, that it is tricking people into thinking they're not taking moral actions when they are. The moral agency is contained within the individual people and their actions, but they're being tricked into thinking they're not moral agents in doing what they're doing because they're simply following their chunk of the protocols. So, yeah, it's morally wrong to work at the DMV, but nobody thinks that. Because nobody sees anybody as responsible for what everybody agrees is bullshit. In California, the registration fee for your car is ridiculously high. There's no...
Okay, I see what you're saying. That makes sense. When you frame it like that, no one thinks anyone's responsible, so they just operate under the assumption that DMV just exists and let's maintain it anyways.
Right, who are you going to blame? Don't blame that poor DMV worker. It's not her fault. Well, yeah, it is. Not just her fault.
Well, yeah, it is.
Fault, but it is her fault, too. She's got her part of the fault. It's not... Their fault exists.
I see it. Because if you blame the government, it's too mystified in the sense that there's no way to pin down any real position or person.
Nobody can be held accountable when it's the government who does shit.
I see. That makes sense. That makes a lot of sense. Is the government is a government natural?
That's a good question.
I'm not sure anything humans do is by definition natural. If you have anything that isn't natural, then that'd be stuff humans do.
Go pee.
If you have something that isn't natural.
That's natural.
If something... Wait, what did you say, Megabro?
He said if it's something humans do, it's not natural, because that's the distinction between that which is natural and that which is not is human-made. And then I said, going pee is natural, and I go pee.
Oh, okay. That's a good response. Well, let's reframe natural then. Natural meaning inevitable.
I think it's inevitable, like adolescence is inevitable. Because humans are made out of plastic, Trick Nasty. Did you forget? Yeah, where I said before I made that joke and forgot what I said before that.
I think you said it was a good question if it was natural or not.
Oh, I think it's adolescence. It's the adolescence of humans dealing with each other. Until we learn to be grown up and deal with each other like we're dealing with each other now. You know, we may disagree about certain things in this room. Some people may think I'm racist for declaring that I'm African American. I may think they're racist for questioning my racial identity. Maybe I don't actually think that too is possible. But you know, but we're not fighting with each other, right? We're not fighting with each other in any sense of the word. I'm not stabbing you in that sense, and you're not stabbing me. And also, even if we're disagreeing vehemently, my hope is that we end the conversation liking each other more for having done so, not less, even if our opinions haven't changed. I am fine with you holding a reprehensible position. I lament the fact that it might contribute to, not you personally, Zach.
Oh, I was like...
No, I'm not talking to you. I mean one in general. I should just say one, you know. But, you know, I'm not talking to you, Zach, or anybody in here specifically. I'm saying people in general, right? If somebody might hold a reprehensible position, but if they're willing to come in here and fight it out with me, then they're on the good guys team, because they're not stabbing anybody, and it's lamentable that they may vote for something that ultimately harms me, and they actually do have more... What's that?
Discourse is just.
Yeah.
That's my claim.
Arguing the worst fucking atrocity in the world, as long as you're in here arguing it with me fairly, you know, like making arguments, responding and shit, is totally fine in my book. It's a good thing to do. If your argument's really that strong, then it's probably not an atrocity at all. So, you know, but that's how come I think that we have to embrace the one framework that allows everyone's wrongness, including mine, right? When people who disagree with the negative rights framework, if they're wrong and they win, somebody's fucked. With the negative rights framework, if I'm wrong, I could be completely wrong, but I win, everyone's fine. Nobody's fucked. No specific group, no specific individual, no specific belief, no specific anything is any more fucked than any other, right? Which is to say, we're all subject to the reality that we live in a world of other human agents, other human moral agents who have the capacity to do great good or great evil.
Okay, what about, for example, does the government have a duty to minimize trends of behavior within a society, even if the individuals under, behavior? Okay, so if, let's say under a negative rights framework, we're allowed a freedom of expression of certain things, right? Voluntary, right?
We're not allowed it. Others don't violate our rights typically on that vector.
Yeah. So there are certain activities that we can engage in, trends of behavior that. I read this book, or I've been reading this book recently. It's called Sex and Culture, and it's by J.D. Unwin. And it was a social anthropologist who he studied under He either studied under, or he was a Freudian he ascribed a lot of Freudian theories. But basically, he was a social anthropologist, and he studied I think like 80 civilizations or something, and he found a trend, a common trend between behavior and civilization flourishing, which was monogamy, monogamous relationships, and prenuptial and postnuptial sexual restriction. So, like, no non-sex before marriage, and then after that, monogamy, right? Under negative rights framework, that would be allowed. But like, polygamy would be allowed as long as it's voluntary, right? But if certain trends of that led to the destruction of a civilization, would that be allowed, or would that be justified?
Right. First of all, it wouldn't be allowed. It would be instead, it would not be to use violence against those people. That would be the rule.
As long as we
have the negative rights framework to defend society against its many, many wrong ideas, then it doesn't matter. If polygamy, in fact, led to the downfall of civilization, downfall of civilization always happens at the point of a fucking sword. It's never because people had too much discourse.
Well, that's exactly it, yeah. What he argues in the book is that, I haven't finished the whole book, so I may have misrepresented the argument, but I think the gist of it so far is that...
gist! You always say that. That word is not pronounced gist. It's pronounced gist.
Is it gist? What did I say? The gist?
Yeah. It's like the fourth time I've heard you do this.
Well, the gist of it, then. The gist of it is that... shit, what was I going to say? So... Repression of sexual energy was because they didn't have freedom of sexual expression, they didn't have liberal moral values regarding sexual expression, that energy went through different aspects, such as building civilization. I guess it was ascribing to higher ideals, like building infrastructure, stuff like that. And that once a society became morally liberal regarding sexual expression, that they lost the sexual energy that manifested throughout the society, and that includes like aggression and stuff too, and that they all ultimately either fell from within or they fell from an outside invader who had stronger sexual energy or stronger aggression, who were more unified.
First of all, this ridiculous metaphor of sexual energy, of like something that is a culture has sexual energy, that is like three metaphors.
The reason he says that is because he identified that in societies and cultures that had repressed sexual norms, so ones that had, I guess, very traditionalist views of sexual expression, that they tend to have more flourishing civilizations at faster rates, stuff like that,
more expansion. They tend to have more conquering civilizations. In other words, in societies where the douchebags won, they engaged in a bunch of fucking douchebaggery. Yeah, no shock there. I mean, yeah, if you get a bunch of SE doms winning, then they're going to be a militaristic society. They're going to expand a lot. They're going to have a lot of inventions and stuff. And, oh, look how great we are because we're so militaristic. We have to come up with a lot of new ideas. Otherwise, we get our ass kicked because we enslave the NTs to our purposes, which is what they do. And then we get a pass, right? We got a good relationship with those dictators because we get a pass. We're not the peasants. We're the ones who help them stay in power.
In response to Trick Nasty, the liberation of women, I think it wasn't liberation of women. I think it was like the family unit was destroyed or something like that. I think that was the core of the argument. Or that the children didn't have sufficient... I haven't finished the whole book.
You can't have part of negative rights framework. You can't have part negative rights. They can't say, oh, you have the negative right to have sexual proclivity, but you don't have the negative right to have sexual proclivity except in the ways that I say, because I'm the man. That's when you get fucking sexual proclivity that destroys things.
Okay,
when people started to control other people's sexual proclivity. People left to their own devices will conclude on their own if left freely and not predated upon by people, not preyed upon, right? There's a lot of fucking sexual predators in the world who aren't considered sexual predators in a legal or sense, but are out to bed as many people as possible or whatever. If you have a society where everyone is legitimized in their own identity in that regard and not subject to pressure and violence to conform to somebody else's identity in that regard, then you don't have any problems. The people who want to be monogamous will be monogamous and will join monogamous relationships. The people who want to be, fuck bunnies will be fuck bunnies.
But, okay, if JD Unwin's research is correct, and that if societies that are more SE-DOM oriented, let's say, are able to, I guess, invade and conquer societies that aren't as SE-DOM-ish and don't have like a sort of dogma that restricts sexual expression like that. But if the goal of a government or the purpose of a government is there to protect the society, shouldn't they, or ought they, advocate for advocate laws that will protect the society against outside invaders?
Okay, but look, Zach, first of all, if in fact this mechanism were a reality, that sexual repressiveness somehow led to success and growth and enlightenment, then why the fuck are Muslim cultures all backwards?
I mean, I don't know.
Right, because it's bullshit, that's why. Even if you could find a correlation, even if his research is sound and he found a good correlation, it's one correlation of infinite number of variables.
But I don't think we've, who knows, like in 100 years, Islamic culture may be the world dominant one.
Not if I'm president. I really want to hear more voices in here, and I keep feeling like I need to do FE dances about it, because I know I naturally am rather talkative, and I want to hear. I don't want people to feel shut out if they have things to say.
I haven't read any of that book, but like most things, if sexual energy is involved or whatever, there's probably a medium point in which everything works optimally, whereas there's too much, it messes up, and there's too little, it messes up.
Wait,
and
repeat
so
the last part. Repeat the last part.
He's just it's something that if there's too little, it's bad. If there's too much, it's bad. It's going to have a equilibrium point.
So if it was the case where a reduction of that energy caused flourishing, it was probably too high in the first place. But there'd be a level in which you repress it too much and it messes up again.
But yeah. The thing is, there's no reason to think that this would be the deciding vector of all the possible vectors in human society. If you think about doing research in the fashion that the research you're referring to, where you're looking at archaeological data and you're looking at societal norms and how they play out and how they correlate with the quote-unquote success of a society, you begin with a insurmountable definition problem. What constitutes success, and what do we count as the norms, and what do we not count as the norms? You're not going to include them all. You're trying to narrow it down to one. How do you eliminate with control group? Your distinctions are all arbitrary anyway, and they're based on some former archaeologist's former work about some former culture that he was making flights of fancy about in the first place.
Well, it wasn't former. It was like 80 different cultures and civilizations, but
right, but which vectors, which mores did he compare? Which ones did he not include? Maybe there was other mores that didn't get included that showed the exact opposite correlation. We don't know, because there's infinite possible correlations to be drawn, because there's no set number of possible mores to examine. You can taxonomy in infinite ways.
That makes sense.
Should we end this one?
How long has it gone on?
It's gone.
How long has it gone on?
44 minutes.
Do you have any more questions about the negative rights framework, Megabro?
No, I think I've got the gist of it. At least the essential center of it. There's a lot of
Did you get the gist of it or the gist of it?
I should probably throw down the arguments against it if you want to hear them real quick.
All right.
I'd be interested.
It's the top arguments against it are the what ifs. If we put people in strongly utilitarianly bad situations, it's hard to argue in favor of a negative rights framework, such that the classic example is fire truck dynamite guy. Fire truck dynamite guy is driving down the freeway. He's got a fire in one half of the bed of his truck. He's got a plywood wall behind that fire. And then on the other half, the other side of the plywood wall, he's got a big pile of dynamite. He's driving down the freeway very slowly with his fire and his dynamite in the back of his truck, and he is violating nobody's rights. And the cop tries to pull him over and says, Hey, man, I have hurt nobody. You are seeking justice for no one. I am merely driving down the road with my campfire and my dynamite, harming nobody. You have no reason to pull me over. That's it. I'm doing nothing illegal. Well, most people would say society has a reasonable interest to say, no, you can't do that. And yet, if we were to say that, then we'd be making an exception to the negative rights framework. The whole point of the negative rights framework is we need to do it without exception. My perspective is, as a pragmatist, we need to always parse in and down, which is my new expression of the day because I came up with this earlier. It's like, that's what we need to do. Always parse in and down is fine. Okay, we can't violate your negative rights. What are we going to do about this? Let's figure out a way around it without violating his rights. How are we going to do that? And then ultimately, if you have to make an exception, you make an exception after executing that protocol first. If we have things framed right, rights violations will be few and far between and only when absolutely necessary rather than standard operating procedure. So I gave you the answers against it, and then I answered those like because I can't help it, I guess.
Fire dynamite guy.
Uh-huh.
That is assuming that everyone around like doesn't know there's this guy driving with fire and dynamite in his truck, and they can't avoid him. If there was perfect information, they could avoid him, and he'd just blow up himself.
Magic Sky Friend. We need Magic Sky Friend.
So.
What if he has really close neighbors? Neighbors.
Well, what I'm saying is.
Information, it would never get to that. With good information, it would never get to that. That's what you're saying. If we have perfect transparency, that guy would never get that far. He would never be that damaged to be that way.
Well, yeah, he'd probably get mental help earlier, but I wouldn't use the word never, but it'd be a lot less likely.
Okay.
Where's it going?
I agree with you on that.
But by him going down the highway with his fire dynamite, he is effectively concealing that he's about to cause a huge disaster. Because people
Except he gets all the way home and he squirts it out with a hose, and there's no disaster. What happens
then? I have another point to bring up. What about... I think we attacked it before, but I'm going to go back into it, just to explain it in the video. That way this video could be, like, super cohesive of, like, negative rights stuff. What about children, right? Like, what if you come over and you're like, hey, Zach, I noticed you locked your kid out of your house, and he looks pretty frail. Like, oh, no, don't worry about it. I give him water, like, twice a day. And you're like, yeah, but isn't he, like, that's bad, right? You shouldn't be isolating your child like that and not treating them. Well, what authority do you have to tell me how I'm supposed to raise my kid?
See, I think right there you're approaching the problem from a non-negative rights framework. My question would be to the kid, hey, are you okay, man? Do you want to come with me? If we had a negative rights framework, the kid would be free to do what he wanted. But look, I agree.
What if that kid wanted to have sex with like a 7-year-old man? A 7-year-old man comes by and he wants to have sex with a 7-year-old kid.
Yeah, okay. I mean, look, the thing is, I am not for affording full negative rights to minors yet. I don't think society's mature enough for it yet. But I do believe that ultimately we need to start affording minors more rights, and we need to start affording them more respect in general. I've got a lot of friends who are kids, and I consider them my friends. I don't consider them my students. I don't consider them just my students, you know? Like Edmund, a debater stuck with me for a couple of years and was there for me when I really needed a debater to be good. I really needed a debater to win, and he was there, and he put a big win for me. That means a lot to me. You know, he's my friend. He's not some kid, right? He's not a former student. He's my friend. He did me a big fucking favor. I appreciate it. So I think people need to treat kids like people is what somebody said there. Treat kids like people. I treat kids like people. I do not treat them like little minions or whatever. I do yell at them a lot, but I yell at them in an affectionate way. But I'm yelling at them in a coach capacity, right? Where I'm yelling because it's my job to as their helper to yell at them at that point. And they know it's my job. And if they don't want my help and they don't want to be there, I will not force them to be there. I won't take kids who, I'll kick them out of my program. They're not happy there, and they don't want to be there. Their parents forcing them. I will kick them out. And I tell all my classes at the beginning of the year too. If you want out, you just come tell me. And if you're worried about your parents or whatever, I can get you out in a way that you're not going to be damaged by it. I'll figure it out. I've yet to have anybody actually take me up on the offer. But
How do these kids find you? Do you advertise like in Temple City or something?
No, I don't really advertise at all. I have my Facebook page, and now I have my Chinese business partner that she's got our phone list of clients that we currently have. The current group I have is comprised a lot of the choir that I partnered with last year. And then there's some former students from CUDA. But I mean, everybody knows who I am, basically, in that community. If you're looking for debate, if you're a middle school parent and you're looking for debate in Southern California, in San Gabriel Valley especially, or Walnut area, you'll know about a few places that are a few options that are good, right? And that's like, CUDA's is on the way down. Nova's on the way up, having benefited a lot from me being fired from CUDA's. And then Autonomy is new. We're in our second year, but we're starting to roll, as we should. We're gonna come in there like a fucking house on fire.
But I think we've gone over enough of the digress real quick back. We should probably wrap up the video, yeah. We've talked a lot about it. This is a really good video. This is like a cohesive, like, we've answered a lot of questions about the framework.
Well, I hope viewers enjoy it, and if viewers or others wish that we had a few more other voices or more contributions from other voices, I'll try to encourage that more in the future. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to eat plenty of cheese.